Okay, so shall I just start, or does Jose Luis say something? Jose Luis, estás muteado.
Thanks. Welcome everyone, and thanks for joining us in this talk. As we know, in the last century, physics led to big revolution that changed how we understand the nature, the gravity theory, and the quantum theory. The last one has its basis on the quantization of the energy, the wave-particle duality, the incertitude principle, and other ones. But this point of view is a qualitative description of a quantum system. In 1932, John von Neumann laid the foundation of how to measure the properties of a quantum system. Today, Dr. Thomas Goring presents us his quantum measurement theory, part of the Quantum and Classical Statistics Physics Seminar. He received his doctoral degree from the Dresden University of Technology, and nowadays he's a professor researcher at the University of Guadalajara and member of the SNI. His research fields are quantum chaos, quantum information, open system, and others. Once again, welcome everyone. For those in the YouTube channel, at the end of the presentation, Dr. Thomas Goring will answer the questions you leave us in the chat, and that's all. It's your time.
Okay, thank you, Jose Luis, for the introduction. And well, as mentioned, I will try to explain to you the basics of quantum measurement. And I will try to do that with as few mathematical expressions as possible. But nevertheless, some mathematics will show up. My starting point will be, say, what we know or what we learned from about quantum measurements in the first quantum physics course. So nevertheless, in the first part of the talk, or the first part of the talk will be a reminder to these things we hear usually in this first lecture on quantum physics. And I will then move to classical discrete measurements. This is something you would mostly not see in a treatment on a quantum measurement theory, but I think it helps to see the differences between classical and quantum measurements and what is so particular about quantum measurements. So then in the third part, we will discuss.
Can you wait for a minute, please? We have a trouble. 1 minute, please.
Okay.
Okay, it's one, doctor. Thank you.
Okay, shall I repeat something or just continue?
Please repeat it. Please.
Okay, so I I repeat the outline of the talk, of the presentation, well, of the lecture. I think it's supposed to be a lecture.
Okay.
So the first point is a measurement theory. So if you only talk about states, there is no link, there is no connection to real experiments. So a state, a physical quantum state, you cannot observe just like a state, right? You can only do measurements and only observe observables. And to describe this theoretically, we need the scalar product. Okay, so then if we have this scalar product and the description of measurements via observables, then we can make predictions about measurements. That is to say, if we know our system is in a certain quantum state, then we can predict measurement outcomes. But also, if we don't know the state, we can just do a measurement and then get information about the quantum state our system is in. Right, so now what you should remember from your first quantum physics course is that the measurement outcomes are the eigenvalues of a Hermitian operator, that is our observable, here denoted by A, capital A. And as I said, well, for simplicity, we assume discreteness. Okay, then our operator A has eigenvalues small a xi, small a sub xi, and it has eigenstates corresponding to these eigenvalues. So all eigenstates corresponding to one eigenvalue form a subspace in this whole Hilbert space. And now this P sub xi is a projector on this subspace. So there may be eigenvalues which have only one eigenvector, right? Then this is a non-degenerate eigenvalue, and the projector projects on a one-dimensional subspace. But there may also be degenerate eigenvalues. Then this projector P sub xi projects on a higher dimensional subspace. And the sum of all projectors should be the identity on the Hilbert space. So that's called a decomposition of the Hilbert space. Okay, and then say you may think about, well, then suppose we know the state of the system. Okay, then prior to the measurement, we know that the system is in state psi, okay? And we can say, I mean, our quantum theory then tells us that we should expect to find measurement outcomes A sub xi with the probability, which is given by the scalar product, well, the expectation value of the projector with respect to the state. Okay, and now that's before the measurement. After the measurement, of course, we know the measurement outcome, right? Then one particular eigenvalue has been measured. And that leads to the so-called wave function collapse. The state of the system will immediately, instantly change to this object, right? So the projector, well, so it's psi, the state of the system, projected into this subspace of eigenstates of A sub psi. Okay, now this is a description of an individual event of a measurement. And the major part of this lecture will be concerned with such individual events, but then we will also discuss cases where we calculate expectation values and where we need to repeat the measurement many times in order to obtain a meaningful result. But that will be called ensemble measurement. Okay, now if you repeat the measurement many times, then you get all kinds of measurement outcomes, right? A few times you will get the eigenvalue A1, a few times you will get the eigenvalue A2, and so on. And then you can say, okay, my expectation value of A will be just the weighted sum of eigenvalues, right? So here are the eigenvalues, and each eigenvalue is weighted with the probability to obtain that eigenvalue as a measurement outcome. Well, this is indicated here. And now mathematically, you can just calculate this expectation value by calculating now the expectation value of the operator A directly. So I guess this is what you should learn in the first physics course about measurements. And now I want to show you an example where we can see the importance of doing ensemble measurements in order to get valuable information about the system. So here I consider the case where you do not know anything about the state of the system, and you do the measurement and you want to learn something about the state. Okay, so as an example, we use this double slit experiment. Young's double slit experiment was carried out with classical light. The first experiment with quantum particles was with electrons. And maybe it's an interesting remark that nowadays you can do such double slit experiments. Well, it's maybe not precisely double slits. It's an experiment with many, many slits, a grating. But you can do this now with molecules, fullerenes, and more recently, even molecules with out to 810 atoms. So these are practically macroscopic particles, right? And nevertheless, when they are thrown against a double slit, right? You cannot tell, I mean, you can have the situation where you do not know, that's maybe not correctly said, whether the particle goes through both slits at the same time, right? And it really creates the interference pattern you expect. So now suppose we have just a double slit experiment and the particles are just perfect particles. And you see that this red curve would be the interference pattern we would expect, okay? And now what has this to do with quantum mechanics? Well, you can interpret, say, if you shoot quantum particles on the double slit and just before hitting the screen or the counters, the array of counters nowadays, you can take, say, the wave function in the or the wave function profile in the direction transverse to the to the ray of particles, or to the velocity, to the to the velocity of your particle, and then you expect the probability density to be of that form shown as a red curve in the plot. Right, so this is a, now you can use this as a wave function, well, as a probability density of a quantum particle in one dimension. But this dimension is the transverse direction to the velocity of the particles, right? Okay, so it should be normalized, so the area beyond, below the curve should be one, and you see that this is approximately fulfilled. I mean, it's exactly a fulfilled, but here you see it, that at least approximately it's correct. And now this is a case where we see the measurement of the position of just one particle, right? So instead of the screen, we have counters. Here I just choose 90 counters arranged in this interval from minus 1.5 to 1.5. And now one counter detects the particle, right? So this is a position, a discrete position measurement. And if you only send one particle, then you only get one event. And what I want to stress here is that with this one event, you get very little or almost no information about the state of the quantum system, right? So just to see, if you compare this black line, black bar with the wave function probability, you see that there is no any, well, connection almost. And this changes, of course, if you increase the number of particles you send through this double slit. And now here we have four. Still, you cannot tell very much about the state of the system. Here we have 13. Now this is plotted, so the histogram, these black bars, are plotted in such a way that they also are normalized. So the area given by the black bars should also be equal to one. Now, that means that if you have very few black bars, they must be very high in order to fulfill this requirement. That's why they, so these are of finite height, but these three black bars, they are much higher, right? They are just cut at this level four. Here we have 140 events. Now you start to see the shape of the wave function. And oops, okay, that's it. Sorry, I thought that we had another picture. That's it. So if you, but I think you will believe that if we take more and more events, then the agreement between the experimental measurement and the theoretical prediction will be better and better. Okay, so this is why ensemble measurements are important if you want to learn something about your system. Okay, so now we come to the second part of the talk. So this is about classical discrete measurements. And we choose this particular type of measurements in order to compare classical and quantum measurements on equal footing. Okay, let's just assume a simple situation and a common situation where we have a classical particle in one dimension, okay? Then what is the state space of this classical particle? What are the states for this classical particle? Well, that you should also remember, right? These are points in phase space. So that just means that in order to uniquely specify the state of a classical particle, you have to define the position and the velocity or the momentum, right? That is practically the same, assuming that the mass of the particle is fixed. Okay, now how do we describe a measurement then in that case? Well, so it means a measurement means a map between the states and the possible outcomes, okay? As I said, we assume that the outcome is discrete. So you can think about the position measurement in the case of just in the case we saw before, right? So you're sending now really classical particles through whatever obstacle, and the particles, then you measure the transversal position of the particle, okay? But you measure it with a discrete setup. So you say if you have these 90 counters, then you only have 90 different possible measurement results, right? So now if you do the measurement and let's assume that it's not ideal, then you may expect that even if you know the state of your particle precisely, you will not get a deterministic result, right? Sometimes you may get one counter to click, and sometimes you may get another counter to click. Whether this happens or not, it depends on your measurement device and how well it is designed. Okay, so then in order to completely describe your measurement, the properties of your measurement device, you should know for any state P, what is the probability to obtain a certain measurement outcome A sub xi. And well, this is this P sub xi. Okay, and now this is completely analogous to the quantum case we discussed before. So far, it is analogous in principle, right? Then there may also be an effect of the implementation of the measurement. Okay, now if you really take counters, then to measure the position of your particles, then the effect of the implementation is that your system, your classical system, is destroyed, right? Once the counter is hit, your classical state does not exist anymore. But assume that you measure the position with a ray of light, for instance, right? And then it's a less invasive measurement, the effect of the implementation of the measurement is can be maybe neglected, maybe there is some effect. So in general, if you, the initial state of your system or the original state of your system was the point X and P in phase space, due to the measurement, this state will change. So you will have another point in phase space. But eventually, you cannot tell which point you will have precisely, right? Because for the same reason that you may not be able to tell precisely what is the measurement outcome, it may happen that if you do the same measurement with exactly the same, with your classical system being in exactly the same state, you may get nonetheless different effects on your on the state of the system. So after the measurement, in one case, you will get the state X prime P prime in your phase space, and in another case, you will get a different point X double prime P double prime in phase space. So that's why, in general, you must describe the effect of the implementation of the measurement by something which maps a state, which is an element of a point in phase space, to a probability distribution in phase space. Right? Because you cannot be sure to which final point a given measurement will map your original state. Okay, so now we will try to describe these different measurements with little diagrams. So here's here are a few of them, well, two of them, say. So CM just stands for classical measurement. So the input to this measurement device now is a state. So for this classical case, it's a point in phase space. And the outcome is a probability vector, right? So even if the state is always the same, you may find different outcomes with different probabilities. Of course, in an experimental situation, you have to repeat this measurement many times in order to determine these probabilities. But you may have a theoretical description which tells you these probabilities beforehand, right? And then this calligraphic M, it's precisely this description. Now you see this block, it describes the measurement, and everything, every arrows which goes downwards, they describe measurement outcomes, and everything which evolves horizontally, that defines what happens, or that characterizes what happens to the state of the system. Okay. Now, as in this double slit experiment, you may have the case where you are not interested at all in what happens to your system, and it may be that your measurement completely destroys the state. So then this is indicated by this shaded border at the right of this block. Okay, but there may also be the situation where you care about what happens, and in fact where you design your measurement in such a way that the original state is as little disturbed as possible. And then you have this situation where you get the same measurement outcome, say, but at the same time you get a certain output state after the measurement, but that is now not deterministic. Okay, so the same input state may be mapped to different in some random way output states, and this randomness you have to describe by a probability density function on the phase space. Okay, now this map, I mean this which goes from the input state to the probability distribution on the phase space, this I call implementation, and it's denoted by a calligraphic I. Okay, so then there are some remarks. For each state, we have one vector of probabilities. That's for the outcome map. A good, or say ideal measurement. So, okay, that, well, in fact, this is a question. So what is a good ideal measurement? And what happens if the measurement is very poor? So where can we see whether the measurement is good or whether it is pure? Poor. Okay, so that's a question to the audience. Any suggestions? Okay, it seems not. Are you still there? Okay, so, well, you see, if a classical measurement is good, so you want to know your measurement outcome precisely, right? Then the same input state should always lead to the same measurement result. Say, if you have a position measurement, then X, right, it is a particular position, so you should always get the same counter to click. So then these probabilities are either 1 or 0. Okay, is that clear? So this means that for any state, you only get one counter to click. Now, if for a certain state, one probability is equal to 1, then all other probabilities have to be equal to 0. And that would be the ideal measurement. So a non-ideal measurement would still have a very high probability for a certain counter to click. And a pure measurement, there would be many counters which click with comparable probabilities. Okay, this remark, ensemble measurements may still be useful. Okay, that's meant, right. If you have an ideal measurement, then you do not need an ensemble. You do not need to repeat the measurement for the same initial state many times. Right, because you get one deterministic outcome and you know for sure that this is the correct answer. But if you have a pure measurement device, then an ensemble measurement gives you a probability distribution, okay, many probabilities, and then you can at least, then what you can do is to calculate an estimate, a best estimate for the true position of your classical state. In the case of implementations, uh, You also have, oh, this is, okay, that, yeah, that's the second question. I'm not, so the first thing is that this is a not very nice to have a map which is between different things, right? From states to probability distributions. So maybe you would prefer to have a map between probability distributions. And that, of course, you can have if you just use an ensemble of initial states, and if they are not precisely the same always. But more important is what is a good implementation and what is a poor implementation. Well, a good implementation would be that it does not disturb the original state. So this probability density would then be a very concentrated probability density on the original state, right? So you may have deviations, but these deviations are very small. That would be a good implementation. And the pure implementation, well, then this probability density would be very broad. Okay, so now we come to the generalized quantum measurements. Okay, so again, we will use little diagrams to describe what we mean. And in the first part, I just reproduce what we said about projective measurements from the first part of the talk. And I now just introduce these maps, which is the outcome map M and the implementation map I, right? Now you see that the outcome map M maps now states, quantum states, to probabilities P xi, as we found. Okay, and the implementation, now it maps states psi to state psi prime. And now even here the point is that this projective measurement is an ideal measurement in a quantum sense, right? So there is no there is no error coming into the game by, so we are assuming that there is no error due to an experimental realization of the measurement, right? What you're describing here is the ideal quantum measurement. Nevertheless, the outcome map is probabilistic, and these probabilities may be not small, well, maybe not small at all, and there may be no single probability equal to one, even though it's an ideal measurement. And the implementation, similarly, so you may have a strong effect due to implementing the measurement. So this is this wave function collapse, right? So if psi is very different from any of the eigenstates of the observable, then the measurement will necessarily have a strong effect on your state. And this is completely independent. So this is completely independent of the way you realize this measurement experimentally. Still, in addition to that, so if this is the ideal measurement, you still may have, of course, non-ideal realizations of the measurement, but that means that things only become worse, right? They cannot become better than this. And in fact, if you want to describe non-ideal measurements, you have to go to these generalized non-projective measurements. Well, you may want to go to this. Okay, so before coming to the generalized, let's just mention complete projective measurements. This is just when all projection operators are one-dimensional. So that has the nice effect that even if you don't know the state, the original state initially, after the measurement, you get the measurement outcome, and then your initial state is projected onto this one-dimensional subspace. So you know your final state after the measurement precisely, right? Since it's a one-dimensional subspace, so you know it exactly. And well, this is the usual way you prepare a quantum system in a certain state, right? So you do a complete projective measurement such that your outcome state, the output states, are completely known. Yes, and now generalized non-projective measurements. Well, this is in fact a little, to do that or to describe these generalized measurements theoretically, it's a bit involved, as you can see. What you try to do is to add to your system an ancilla system. So this ancilla system represents, it's a theoretical representation of your measurement apparatus. And then you say, okay, my ancilla system will have some observable that may be a position variable, right, which will tell me about the observable I'm actually measuring on my system. Okay, so suppose I want to measure energy of my system. I may connect my system to some ancilla system which has a position variable such that the position variable gives me information about the energy of the system.
Dr. Gorin, Soham has a question.
Okay, yes, please.
Yeah, what do you mean by ancilla system?
Okay, it's maybe any quantum system, any additional quantum system with a degree of freedom which I can measure, right? And I will measure this degree of freedom with a projective measurement, so these standard measurements we know.
So that's a quantum system you know completely?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, so
okay,
it's meant, so for instance, it's called ancilla systems because it may be the ancilla, you think it is the ancilla of a, say, clock. Well, this old-fashioned clock, right? And these ancillas, it can show different properties of your system. If your system is a car, so this ancilla may show you the velocity of your car. It may also show you the level of fuel which remains in your car. Okay, so in this sense, the system you are measuring is either the velocity of the car, and think that, or say the velocity of a quantum particle, and the ancilla is a position variable, say, or the angle of the ancilla, if you have insist on having an ancilla, which you measure by a projective measurement. Okay.
Thank you.
So now the complete procedure goes as this. So you take your state of your system, you extend this with your ancilla being in the state, in some basis state. So this is always the same initial state, let's call it zero, then you do some unitary evolution of system and ancilla. This is denoted by this e to the minus the Hamiltonian, right? T is time, h bar is the Planck constant. Now, in order to couple your system to the ancilla, you have your Hamiltonian, which has a system part, an ancilla part, and this coupling part. So important is really only this coupling part. And so you see this AS, this is the observable you want to measure in your system. And this QA, this is the degree of freedom or the observable, yeah, it's better to say. The observable, now I'm not sure. No, it's, okay, it, in any case, it's an operator for the degree of freedom of your ancilla system you want to measure. So the property of your system, with respect to A, so the value, yeah, so if A is energy, say, right, then the energy of your system controls the change of your ancilla variable, right? So if the energy is large, say, then this Hamiltonian will lead to a large change of the position variable of your ancilla. If the energy is small, then this Hamiltonian will lead to a small change of the position value, of the position variable of the ancilla. And since you start out from a certain state, now a small state will leave the ancilla at the small position, and a large change will leave the ancilla at the large position. Okay? So, yeah, it's just not possible to make a complete mathematical description of all that. I just want to convey the general idea of this concept. Okay? So once you do this evolution, the state of the system gets entangled with the state of the ancilla. And that is how properties of the system get imprinted on the state of the ancilla system. And now you do this a complete projective measurement on your ancilla system. And so you get measurement outcomes. And as it turns out, these measurement outcomes tell you something about the observable you want to measure in your system. Of course, you have to design everything appropriately in order to achieve this goal, right? Also, what happens is that once you have a measurement outcome, there is a wave function collapse taking place, but now it's a collapse of the entangled state of system and ancilla. And since your ancilla system will be at the end in a one-dimensional state, which you know completely because of this measurement outcome, any entanglement with the system will be destroyed. So you can say that you leave your system again in a pure state, independent of your ancilla system, but that this pure state is also affected, disturbed by that measurement. This is because the measurement collapse takes place for the entangled state. Right, so I think this is all what I think I said everything I mentioned there. Okay, and now you can just put, so this is the same diagram. Now I just put it into a gray box, right? And now I can interpret this as a generalized measurement of my system alone. Because the input is a state psi, which is a state of the system. The output is psi prime, which is again a state of the system. And the measurement outcomes, which are measurement outcomes of this complete projection, complete projective measurement. But anyway, these outcomes, they will depend on the state of the system, because that's the only thing we change in this scheme. Okay, so now more condensed, we have this. Psi comes in, a certain measurement result will come out here, and the measurement, the implementation of the measurement, again, will affect that state psi, so you get psi prime. Now it turns out that you can describe now these measurement outcomes, better to say the map of measurement outcomes, and the map which describes the effect of measurement on the state by operators on the Hilbert space. So you have a finite or at least a countable set of operators which allow to describe the measurement outcomes and the implementation, the effect of the implementation on the states. So first the measurement outcomes, so now this is comes here. So M is this set of operators. These operators are denoted by E1, E2, and so on. And they are such that given the state psi, the probability to obtain a measurement outcome psi is P sub psi, the expectation value of the measurement operator E psi with respect to psi. And now these measurement operators, they fulfill this equation, they decompose the identity. So they are not projectors. And for the implementation on the state, you need a different set of operators. These are called Gauss operators. And then, say, if your initial state is psi and your measurement outcome is psi, then the state after the measurement is given by the operator K sub psi applied to psi. Here I write that it is proportional to, because this as an operation alone will not give you a normalized state. So if you want psi prime to be normalized, you have to normalize it afterwards. Okay, now we can see what are, this is another question, yes. So what are K psi and E psi in the case of a projective measurement? Well, that's another question to the public. it, for instance, in the case of the outcome map. What happened? Can you still see? Oh, I think this was the internet problem of the university then. Yes. Sorry. Okay. So look at the outcome map, right? In the case of the projective measurement, we had here P Xi instead of E Xi, right? So for projective measurement, these E's are just the projectors. And in the case of the implementation, we also had the wave function collapse as a projection of Psi to the subspace, well, done by the projector P Xi again. So these K's, these K are also the projectors in a projective measurement case. And the whole point is that if you have a generalized situation, then these E's are no longer projectors, but they still decompose the identity. So they are no longer projectors, but they must be positive operators. Okay, so sorry, this I should have said. A positive operator is an operator which has real eigenvalues, and all eigenvalues must be non-negative. In other words, it's a Hermitian operator with non-negative eigenvalues. These Krauss operators, they can be anything. They just can be any kind of operator. But they still have to decompose the identity if you do this combination. now then a few remarks. Every implementation, so if I just know the Krauss operators, I can define the I can still know about the outcome map, right? Because if I define the E Xi as this combination, K Xi dagger K Xi, then this gives me a valid outcome map. And so if I know the implementation, I can reconstruct my outcome map, right? But if I have the outcome map, I cannot necessarily reconstruct the implementation, or maybe saying this more clearly, in order to implement a certain measurement with certain operators Xi, you can use different implementations. A trivial case is that you take your original Krauss operators and you just multiply them by a unitary operator. Then you get a new set of Krauss operators, but it leads to the same set of measurement operators. And well, in fact, this is trivial, okay? Because if you do your generalized measurement as seen here, you can always add at the end of the measurement a unitary operator, okay? And that will give you different final state psi prime, and it will obviously not affect the measurement outcomes. Okay, now the interesting question is whether these are the only ways to have different implementations. And the answer is, well, we expect that they are not the only ones, but we do not know. In fact, this is something we are investigating, actually. Okay, now I come to the last point of my lecture. These are ensemble measurements. So I'm just looking at how much I should tell you about that. Okay, let me. So you see that up to now we have discussed measurements event by event, right? So there was a certain initial state psi, and then we wanted to look what happens. And now we go to this more realistic or more frequent case where we have many possibly identical initial states. And possibly they are not identical. Okay? So say we have a sample of systems, a large collection of systems, where we find with probability qj the state psi j. Okay? And let's directly jump to this formula in blue, in the blue box. Okay, so we can describe this sample with this notation. But in this sample, we find states psi j with probability qj. And then the outcome map, what will it do to that, right? Well, so for each system which is in the state qj, it will produce the outcome psi with probability given here, right? Psi j, the expectation value of e psi with respect to psi j. Now, but if we have psi j's in our sample with the probability qj, then the new, say, measurement outcome probabilities are given here. So it's the weighted sum of these expectation values. And now the thing is that you can write this formally as a trace of a product of two operators, where one is e xi. That is nice, because this defines our outcome map, result xi, and a quantity which only depends on the states in our sample and the probabilities with which these states occur. So this is called the density matrix. Okay, and now let's see what happens with the state itself, right? Under the implementation of the measurement. Now, this implementation is a more complicated thing because it's a conditional map of states, right? The result of the map depends on the measurement outcome. So here, this is the case for a single element of the sample. And what is should be noted here, we do not really need to know psi, the state itself, as an element of Hilbert space. It's enough to know the projector on that state, because measurement outcomes at the end only depend on projectors. So then how does the projector evolve under the implementation? Okay, so you have two, for the single state, we have k psi times psi j. And for the projector, of course, we have now k psi psi j, the ket, and the bra of this thing, right? And that's how the Hermitian conjugate of K sub psi comes in. And now if we take the ensemble, okay, so we just take these results with the corresponding probabilities, Q sub j, we get again a simple expression in terms of the density matrix. So we simply get k psi applied to rho, and then multiplied by k psi Hermitian conjugate. So this would be the sample we obtain under the condition that the measurement outcome is psi. Okay, so it's a map between density matrices and density matrices. So in order to get this density matrix properly, you need to normalize. That's why I write here again proportional to. But this normalization issue is the same as in the case of the pure states. Okay, so you see that this quantity, the density matrix, is enough to completely specify what happens to your system, say, better to say, to your sample of systems under a measurement. Okay, and now here it is again written in more concise manner, right? Now the outcome map is just given by this. So rho, your initial sample or your initial ensemble, is mapped to probabilities given here. And it is mapped to different samples, different ensembles, as indicated here, well, depending on the measurement outcome. One thing one should keep in mind about these density matrices is that different samples may be described by the same density matrix. So formally, I can define different sets of, let me just go back. Yeah, here in fact, say different sets of states in my sample, which give the same density matrix. But even so, this may be worrisome. In fact, it can be shown, and it's really true, that these samples or these ensembles, they are simply not distinguishable by any measurement. So you should consider them identical, right? I mean, it makes no sense to call, say, two states different, or to call two states different if you cannot distinguish them by experimental means. Even hypothetically, right, you cannot distinguish them. Okay, so now this is my, this is my last slide. Perfect. Yes. Okay, so let me just remove. Yes, okay. Okay, so now I want to distinguish between selective and non-selective measurements. And what we have been discussing so far are in fact selective measurements, right? Or the selective case. We discussed the outcome state or the outcome sample of our measurement, assuming that we obtained a certain measurement outcome. So here, so in principle, what you can do with such a case is that you can split your measurement outcome according to your, sorry, you can split the state which comes out of your measurement according to your measurement outcome. Okay, so if your measurement outcome is A1, so psi equals 1, you get one sample of states. Of course, this is a sample with less elements, but it's still a sample of states. And you can separate these from those you get if your measurement outcome is A2, so psi equals 2, and from those if your measurement outcome is an arbitrary A psi. Okay? All of these are subsamples, and in principle you can devise a measurement apparatus which separates these subsamples to continue working with each subsample separately. You can also consider the, okay, so I think I lost somebody. At least there is one person who admits that he is lost. Okay.
No, I'm lost here. Maybe there was 2-3 seconds I couldn't hear you. So can you please repeat once more the difference between selective and non-selective cases? I'm lost, a little lost.
Yes, in fact, what I have not yet talked about non-selective cases. So far, everything I explained was the selective case, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because, so there is a state coming in. So this row represents a large number of systems in some states. So there is one state coming in. Then you get the measurement outcome, which is some value for psi, right? Psi equals to 1, 2, 3. That's the measurement outcome, A psi, right? The eigenvalue of your observable.
Okay.
And then if your measurement outcome is A1, you get this. Well, you get one outcome state. If your measurement observable is A2, you get another outcome state. Now you can do this also with your ensemble. Right? So you have many systems coming in, but whenever you get a click for psi equals 1, you move the corresponding state to one line of output. If you get the click in, say, psi equals 2, you move your state to another line of output. So you separate your output states with respect to your measurement outcome. And now that gives you different samples, right? Because different input, so you see, there. Different input states may still yield the same measurement outcome. Okay, a psi 1 which comes in here gives you a certain measurement outcome. Another state gives you the same measurement outcome. It happens with a different probability, but it still happens. Mm-hmm. So what you collect here is you don't care about the initial states, or you don't care about the states. Yeah, the initial, you don't care about the states of your initial system, of your system coming in. You only care that the outcome is 1, right? That's how you collect these output states.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. So in a way, you have a switch right here that whenever you get an outcome, you change, say, the switch, so this output state will move to a different line, to a different sample. And well, you can also design your experiment in such a way that you do not include any switch, right? Whatever comes in, you measure and it comes out. But that means that you have to, here, you just have the union of all outputs, of all subsamples, right? So while these are conditional outputs for each line, here we have the union of all outputs. And then, for instance, this conserves probability. Say, this sample rho prime has the same size as the original sample rho. Because all systems which come in into your measurement device, they come out and they are taken into account. So this map, it's again a map, right? Because you map rho to rho prime, it is trace preserving because it conserves, and that means that it conserves that all systems are taken into account. No system is lost. So the number of systems is conserved. Now, this non-selective case is of special importance because it gives a construction scheme for what we call quantum channel, which is the most general operation you can apply to a state, to a quantum state. And this quantum channel is also called a completely positive and trace preserving map. So it's CPTP map, if you have heard it. And the difference between this selective case and the non-selective case lies in that word trace preserving, right? The selective case is not trace preserving because the number of elements in your sample is less than originally, but it's still completely positive. And okay, so that's it, right? Now, usually you denote a quantum map in such a form with a lambda, right? Then rho is mapped to rho prime, which is lambda of rho. It's a linear map, as you can see. And now this is the last two statements I want to make. So each POVM, that means each measurement which is defined by its outcome map. So each outcome map, you may say, is for each of them, there exists several different implementations, right? So if you have a POVM, which is this set of measurement operators, then there are different sets of Gauss operators which implement that measurement. And also, if you have there are different quantum channels, a certain quantum channel may be obtained as a result of different implementations of a non-selective measurement. That's to say, there are different sets of Gauss operators which define the same quantum channel via this formula here. Okay, here we come to the end of this lecture. There is no summary, unfortunately. If you have some questions, I will try to answer them.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Gorin. So let's start with the question. Let me see. Okay, Alejandro Contreras has a question.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello.
What people call weak measurements is the case you said before when the interaction with between the ancilla system and your system is weak? Is just yes. That or?
Yes, it is just that. Let me go back to this here. Yes, in fact, it is just that. So in this sense, any generalized measurement, you may call it a weak measurement, but eventually people consider a special limit where you take, say, this effect of, well, the interaction between system and ancilla, you take it really to zero, increasing while increasing the number of, well, you have to increase the sample size accordingly in order to still get reasonable outcomes.
Okay, thank you very much.
It's okay, well, maybe I should correct myself here, because it's also important that you restrict yourself to one of these you have to do a selective measurement. Okay, maybe I'm really no, okay, I'm not sure if I remember it well, because it can be that you do two measurements in a line, right? One first measurement and then one second selective measurement. And then you select the measurement outcomes of your first measurement. So what's called post-selection, right? So unfortunately I cannot draw anything on this in this screen. So imagine you do a measurement and you have measurement outcomes, but then you only consider those outcomes where a secondary measurement give you a certain result.
Okay.
And then this first measurement, this must be still a general measurement, and then you get you get some strange counterintuitive results, like expectation values, which are lying outside of the spectrum of your observable.
Okay.
Yeah, so I think the short answer is that weak measurements involve generalized measurements, but they are more complicated than that. You have to do two of them in a row, right? One after the other.
Okay.
So, yes.
Thank you, doctor.
Mm-hmm. Anyone? Any more? We have a question from the YouTube. Maybe it's not too related with the... Would you talk? but Sebastian Kelly asked, it is possible to use a Fourier transformation in order to obtain results based on the frequency? And if it is possible, it could be useful to obtain information about the energy of the system?
Yes, in fact, if we think about position and, position measurements, mm-hmm. This is what is usually done. I mean, here in this scheme, One can work this out in much more detail, right? So you want to do in a sense unprecise measurement of this observable AS. So what you do is, depending on the state of, okay. Jose Luis, can I continue or is it for? Depending on the state of your system, you want to apply some change in your ancillary system. And in fact, so what you do here, if I remember well, this Q would be rather, if this is position in your ancillary system, then the observable you should measure in your ancillary system would be the conjugate variable of position, which would be momentum. If you want to measure position, as that was what I explained when we had where at that point, then you should choose this Q as a momentum operator. And it has, you know, that the eigenvectors or the eigenstates of the momentum operator are plane waves. So the transformation from position eigenstates to momentum eigenstates is a Fourier transform. So here this comes in. So the Fourier transform plays a role in this particular schemes. Yes. I mean, that is what I can say.
Okay, thank you. Soham has another question, please.
So you said that what is complete measurements, and then you go for this generalized measurement, and from there these details of the different operator formalisms. But can you please give, for better understanding, can you please give one example of some system or state where you cannot do complete measurements?
No, I think this is not the issue. I mean, you can always do a complete measurement in principle.
Okay.
But maybe you don't want to do the extra effort, right? Say you have a three-dimensional system with spherical symmetry, okay? And then you know that the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian are degenerate in momentum, angular momentum quantum numbers,
okay.
Right? Because your system conserves the energy, but it also conserves angular momentum. So then, now if you only measure energy, you have to deal with that fact that eigenvalues are degenerate. Right, the energy eigenvalues are degenerate. Now, of course, you can also measure then angular momentum and get your state exactly, right? In that sense, you can always, if you start with a projective non-complete measurement, you can always turn it into a complete measurement by measuring an additional observable afterwards.
So you are basically saying it's about a choice and not limitations.
Yes.
Okay.
So it may be an experimental limitation, but mm-hmm. Yes.
Fine. Okay. Another question? Okay, from YouTube, that's all. And maybe from people here in the meeting also. So, well, thank you very much, Dr. Gorin, for your talk, for all the viewers and people in the meeting. So, see you the next Thursday where Dalia Hernandez Gallegos, we will talk about random matrix theory. So, see you everybody. Thank you.
Okay, see you.
Thank you.